brothers, Tzvi and Bezalel Levin. And I'm going to explain to you why we're starting with music. One of my holy teachers in Erets Israel, a great Kabbalist, the Habad persuasion, many years ago told me that, you know, the Gemara says that you should start a shiur, a Torah lecture, with a milta de bichuta. That's the custom. To start with a joke, some humor, some levity, lighten up. And that's recorded in the Gemara, that the Rava would start with a milta de bichuta. So one of these holy teachers of mine, he should live and be well, many years ago told me that we could be yotzei this inyan of Mila de Bichusa with the nigger. So I'm going to spare you my humor, which is terrible. And instead, I'm going to present to you the most fantastic Negina Jewish music, and specifically something that pertains to this place that we're in. You know, every place has its own energy, its own vibration. So this is a place where there's a lot of Torah being learned that goes back to the great Rav Chaim Halevi Soloveitchik, Rav Chaim Priska. Now, unfortunately, we don't know a niggun of Rav Chaim Priska, but we're going to do the next best thing. We're going to bring to you a niggun of Rebbech Ber. Rebbech Ber Leibovitz, the Birka Shmuel, was the greatest Talmud of Rav Chaim Priska. In fact, they just informed me that when Rebbech Ber would compose a niggun, he would get the stamp of approval of his Rebbe, Rav Chaim Priska. So this niggun has been vetted. It comes from Rebbech Ber, and it got the stamp of approval of Rav Chaim Priska. And these holy Balei Menagin will tell you more about the niggun.
All right. What's the word of the song? The words are Nigashena Bolivia Air. That means that I am asleep, but my heart is awake. And for me, I just came back from Israel 3 months ago. I lived in Tzfat for like 7 years, and I lived in Jerusalem for about 3 years. And for me, in a way, and in a sense, it reminds me of American Jewry. It's kind of like we're all asleep, we're all doing the routine, but our heart is kicking, it's pulling us to the Holy Land, it's pulling us home. So for me, this is like a passionate song, even though it's a Hasidish feeling, this word that we're saying, but it's coming from a Lithuanian approach for Rav Baruch Ber, so it's kind of, it's a unique package. And I sing this, we sing this in honor of Rabbi Avrami over here, who is the sponsor of this event, of all the food and all the beauty, and all of us to get together in this barren land.
We all came to hear Rabbi Naor speak, not me, so I'm just going to keep this very brief. Rabbi Bezalel Naor is a prolific author and thrilling teacher of Jewish thought, Kabbalah, and Hasidism, specializing in the writings of Rabbi Avraham Yitzchak HaKohen Kook. Reviewers have lauded the creativity, depth, and erudition of his work. A popular speaker, he is well known for making even the most esoteric topics come alive for audiences of all levels. So, without further ado, Rabbi Bezalel Naor.
Excuse me, I don't know if other people are finding this, but being right in front of the light, we can't see your face, and it's kind of part of the eye.
Well, there's no curtains.
All right, so I'll go over here.
We can move the sender over if you want.
I think she's trying to say she wants us to play a little more. No,
I would like it.
How's that, okay?
Much better.
Yeah.
There's a glare over there.
I don't usually wear a suit, but in honor of Rabbi Lintup, I'll put on a suit. First, let me give you the lay of the land. I'm going to speak, and we'll have Q&A afterwards, question and answer. And then, for those who are interested, we have some Seforim on the table, and I'll do a book signing. And I know this is a yeshiva, and it's the custom to interrupt in the middle of the shiur, but we do live in the United States of America temporarily, so we'll do the minhag of the greater makom. Please, no interruptions during the shiur. And I invite questions and comments, critiques, attacks, whatever, afterwards. No spitballs. I want to thank Michael Altaraz, the head of the Seforim Sale, for making this possible. I also want to thank Moshe Isaacson, who's not here today, who works at Yeshiva University, with whom I had the pleasure of learning Bechavruta for some years. And I want to thank Rabbi Avraham Manes, a man of vision, tarte mashma. That's an inside joke. He is, bli ayin hara, an incredibly far-sighted individual. He is brilliant in Torah, in midot, and also business. And as the Balei Magadim, excuse me, the Balei Menagnim told you, he's really the one who engineered this entire event. So I want to thank Avraham. The Gemara Brachas of Zayin Amud Bet, very famous Gemara, says Shmog Garim. It's all in the name. The name of the man whom we're going to be discussing today is Pinchas. And Chazal say Pinchas ze Eliyahu. This man is my Eliyahu Hanavi. He came to me at one of the darkest hours in my life. We learned in the Me'er Shiloach, we have an ongoing shiur in the Ishvitzer Rebbe's Me'er Shiloach. We learned in the shiur a couple of weeks ago a beautiful interpretation of the pasuk in Shir Shirim, Dodi Shalach Yado Min Achor. My beloved extended his hand from the hole. I was in the chor. I was in a black hole. It's called MSKCC. It's Nachsanya downtown, Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center. And it was a terrible time in my life. I had just lost my father. I got up from the shiva to learn that I had a life-threatening disease and went through some kind of medical procedures. I was in the chor. I was in the black hole, not of Calcutta, Manhattan. And my beloved extended his hand from the hole. My beloved, that's Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen Lintup. And the way it came about was a granddaughter of his by the name of Hadassah Linfield, her married name is Weingarten, contacted me. She saw that a book of mine, which is downstairs, I don't see it on the table here, was being publicized. It's called The Limit of Intellectual Freedom, Full Chofesh at the Od, based on letters of Rav Kook. And she didn't know. Oh, you're from the Birzh. Yeah. She didn't know so much about her grandfather, but one thing she knew, that her grandfather was a brother, not a biological brother, but a soul brother to Rav Kook, Avram Yitzhak HaKohen Kook. And she asked me if I would undertake this project. By the way, she's not here today. She just lost her brother and sister-in-law within 1 week, husband and wife, who was named after Rabbi Lintup. In America, the name became Linfield, and her brother, David, his name, David Pinchas Linfield, he was a brilliant mathematician, and otherwise she would have been here, but she just lost her brother and sister-in-law. Now, back in 2011, she came into possession of manuscripts, hitherto unpublished manuscripts of her grandfather, this great Lithuanian Kabbalist, Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen Lintup, who was a Rav of Birzh. And really, we all owe a debt of gratitude to Hadassah, because she rescued these writings. These writings were about to be put out on the street, literally. I don't want to go into all of the details, but that's the truth. Someone had passed away in the family, and if it was not for Hadassah, who stepped in at the right time and performed a rescue mission, these holy writings of this great Kabbalist would have been lost. So, I had a project. Hundreds of papers in a state of total disarray because they were about to be put out on the stoop, so to speak. And they're like pieces of a jigsaw puzzle that I had to put together and try to make some sense of, try to find a coherent picture that held all of these pieces together. And there were times I felt that the min ha-shamayim, I was being guided, which piece to put with which other piece to get the picture. And friends, students of mine, when I began to discuss with them this project, begged me, Rabbi Naor, please do not do this. This will be the mistake of your life. This will effectively be the end of whatever little career you've had until now. Because Rabbi Lintup, Pinchas Eliyahu, he had a streak in him of Kana'ut. He was very outspoken. He was not politically correct. And he could go up against the greatest giants of the generation. He's fearless. And the centerpiece of this book is his critique of the Leshem. Now, my friends and students said, Rabbi, you don't mess with the Leshem. The Leshem is sacrosanct. Anybody who knows anything about Lithuanian Kabbalah, you don't mess with the Leshem. Another work critiqued by Rabbi Lintop is a work by the Chafetz Chaim. They said, Rabbi, you're crazy, you're insane. You know, and he's crazy too. Anybody who would dare critique a sefer of the Chofetz Chaim must be a madman, must be a lunatic. And you know how it is when you have a mission, especially Dodi Shalach Yado Menachor. I felt that this is my mission now. And I thank my friends and my students for their sage advice and counsel, but I went ahead with the project. I didn't want Rabbi Lintop to end up like Rabbi Menachem de Lonzano. Anybody know who Rabbi Menachem de Lonzano is? We have historians here. Exactly, that's my point. The reason nobody here has ever heard of Rabbi Menachem de Lonzano was because he was the only Kabbalist in history to critique Rabbi Chaim Vital and the Ari. So therefore, nobody's ever heard of him. Writings of his have been published, but the critiques of Rabbis Vital and Luria have been expunged. So I didn't want to happen to Rabbi Lintop what happened to Rabbi Lonzano, Ramdal, Menachem de Lonzano. I wanted to preserve for posterity his hasagot, his critique of the Kabbalah of the Leshem, because I felt that it's important. Now, the title of this presentation is A Rift Between Kabbalists, but you must know that Rabbi Lintop, like his soul brother, Rav Kook, is multidimensional. Yes, he is a Kabbalist. He's also a Baal Halacha. He's a great Halachist. And he's also a political commentator. He's a pundit. In fact, one of his Sforim, entitled Mamar Binyan HaUmah, which was published in 1907 in the aftermath of the Russo-Japanese War, 1904-1905, makes an amazing prediction, which is coming true now. And that is that these two ancient peoples, Japan and Israel, will emerge into the modern era and take technology by storm. And he saw that there would one day be some kind of significant interaction between these two old new peoples, the Japanese and the Israelis. Amazing, right? As you know, Israel and Japan have signed treaties for advanced technology. Israeli Prime Minister visited Japan. The Japanese Prime Minister just visited Israel. Rabbi Lintop foresaw this. I said that Rabbi Lintup was a Kanai, but the Leshem was also a Kanai. He was a zealot. And in fact, I was told this by my teacher, Rabbi Shlomo Fisher, Shlita Yerushalayim, that the Baal HaLeshem, Rabbi Shlomo Elyashiv, whose grandson, the Posek HaDor, Rabbi Yosef Shalom Elyashiv, just passed away a couple of years ago, over 100 years old, but his grandfather, the Baal HaLeshem, was a Kanoi. In fact, when the Leshem arrived in Yerushalayim, some of the local Kanaim in Yerushalayim tried to enlist Rabbi Elyashiv in the service to go up against Rav Kook. And Rav Kook and Rabbi Shlomo Elyashiv had been friends back in Lithuania. In fact, Rav Kook studied Kabbalah by the Leshem. And Rav Kook was the one who brought the Leshem to Erets Israel. The Leshem and his daughter and son-in-law, Rav Ram Elyashiv, and grandson, Yosef Shom Elyashiv, was a boy. It was Rav Kook who brought them from Homel to Yerushalayim. And despite that, the Kanaim, who had an ongoing jihad against Rav Kook, tried to enlist the Baal HaLeshem. And he almost went for it, but thank God he wised up in time. Back in the old country, if you know, you would know geography, where the Leshem lived in Shavuot, and where Rabbi Lintup lived, Birzh, those two shtetlach are close to one another. They're in close proximity. It's called the Gubernia, the old days under the Tsarist rule. It's the province of Kovna. So they were contemporaries, these two great Lithuanian Kabbalists. They were also neighbors. They lived in neighboring cities. One lived in Birzh and the other lived in Shavuot. And Rabbi Lintup writes to Rav Kook that I suffered a lot from the Kana'ut of the Leshem. He told the townsfolk of Birzh that I'm an apikoros. Now, I don't want to think that this critique of the Leshem is payback time, although it's tempting. I want to think that it's purely ideological, that they have a machloket, they have a theoretical schism on a very rarefied point of Kabbalah, which we will get into. But you must know that there is that background. There was personal enmity between the two great men. Before I get into their machloket in Kabbalah, which, as I said, is very rarefied. It's good we're on the 12th floor here. Matim, it's Zugepasst. Yeah, because we're going to be oskim b'dvarim ha'omtim b'rumo shel olam, things that are very high and mighty. But before we get into that, let me share with you some of the halacha of Rabbi Lintup. Some years ago, Professor Mark B. Shapiro wrote a book, The Limit of Orthodox Theology. Did anybody read that book? Okay. It's a very interesting book. What it attempts to show is that, contrary to common belief, the Yud Gimel Ikarim the Rambam, the 13 articles of belief, were never universally accepted by Gedolei Yisrael. And in the ensuing generations, ensuing centuries, many times various Gedolei Yisrael would have their own daya, which differed from what the Rambam had written in the 13 articles of faith. And if anybody read the book, you know that the book created quite a stir, sensation. It was a pitzatza, it was a bomb. Because here a lot of rabbis and Rosh Yeshivas were telling people that if you don't believe in the Yud Gimel Ikarim, you're not a Jew in good faith. And along comes Professor Mark B. Shapiro and says, Lahadam, lo yudvarim olam. And he shows you, he documents that this gadol was cholek on this ikar, and this gadol was cholek on that ikar. So you can imagine how it sent shockwaves through our community. Well, a man who did that before Professor Mark B. Shapiro was Rabbi Pinchas HaKohen Lintup of Birzh. In one of his svarim, and maybe this is why the Leshem told the people of Birzh that Yehovah is an Abikaris, Rabbi Lintup did this. He didn't write an entire book the way Professor Shapiro did. He wrote a few pages which were damaging enough. And he said that this whole notion of the Rambam is not Talmudic Judaism. This is not rabbinic Judaism as we knew it before the Rambam came along. He said this whole idea of a catechism is foreign to Judaism. And what he found most disturbing was the punch, the execution. According to the Rambam, someone who does not subscribe to one of these 13 articles of faith is an apikoros and has a din, moridim velo malim. And in fact, Rav Amram Bloy, who founded the Torah Karta, quotes this Rambam. Usually, if you know anything about halakha, there's due process of law. There's hatra'ah, shnei edim, and it's very difficult to ever execute anybody. You know, we didn't have a lot of beheadings. But according to Rambam, somebody who's an apikoros, Moridim v'lo ma'alim, quoted by Rabbi Amram Bloy, who finally was the ideological father of the Neturei Karta movement. So, Rabbi Lintup did not exaggerate. This is a very dangerous Rambam, especially when it falls into the wrong hands. Believe that everything in this world is hashgacha pratit, everything is divine providence. Yesterday I was preparing for the shiur after the shiur, and I'm not going to go into it, I'll spare you. It's trying to find a pattern in all of the machlokot, Beit Shammai, Beit Hillel, like a unified field theory. And there are men who have attempted it. It's kind of foolhardy, but I am a fool. And so I'm looking at the Gemara Shabbos, Daf Lamed Aleph, and there's three stories there where a ger, a potential convert, comes first to Shammai, who rebuffs him, and then goes to Hillel, who accepts him, very famous. One of the three anecdotes is about a ger who asks, how many Torahs do you have? Oh, two. Torah Shebichtav, Torah Shebalpeh, the written Torah, the oral Torah. So he says, I'm down for the Torah Shebichtav, for the written law, not the oral. He goes to Shammai. Shammai was a captain, a vekduvoi, get out of here. Goes to Hillel. Hillel says, it's beautiful. Love you, brother. And Hillel is Megayer him. He accepts him as a convert. He's now a Jew. And so Hillel starts to teach him the Aleph Beis. Aleph Beis Gimel Dalet. Then he comes back the next day. Hillel reversed it. Tashrag. Tav Shen Resh Kosod. The Ger says, but Rebbe, yesterday you said it's Aleph Beis Gimel Dalet. I said, Lloyds, you believe me? Okay, so then if you believe me about this, this Masorah, this tradition of which way the Aleph Beis reads, Aleph Beis Gimel Dalet, Tav Shen Resh Kof, so believe me about the Torah Shebal Peh. Now, the halachic ramifications of what Hillel did are just mind-boggling. And Rashi, who, yes, is a Parshan and not a Paskan, you know, he's not a Posek, he's a commentator. Listen to what Rashi says. I'm trying to justify Rabbi Lintop's halachic position. And in a moment I'll show you how Rav Kook, his brother, was on the same page from Yitzhak HaKohen. But first I'll give you my Pirush Rashi, no pun intended. Rashi says, Samach al Chochmato. Hillel was relying on his wisdom, on Hillel's wisdom. Shesofo shiyargilenu lekabel alav. Hillel believed, he was confident that he could finally prevail upon him to accept the Torah Shebaal Peh as well, the oral law. The Lo dam yaha lechutz mitavar echad. What's bothering Rashi? There's a Gemara Bechorot, Daf Lamed Amud Bet, which says that if a ger comes and he's willing to accept everything, chutz midavar echad, and then there's the clarification, afilu dikduk echad midivrei sofrim, we can't accept him. Well, here it's more than davar echad, it's the entire corpus of the Torah Shebaal Peh, how the Hillel did he accept him. That's what's bothering Rashi. Delodam, it's not like that scenario where the ger stipulates chutz midavar echad. Why? Listen to Rashi. Shelo haya kofer b'Torah Shebaal Peh. The ger did not deny the oral law. Ela shelo haya mamin shehi mipi hakvura. He just didn't believe that it's from the mouth of God. He didn't reject it. He just didn't believe in the divine origin of the Torah Shebaal Peh. And Hillel was confident that after he will teach him, the ger will rely upon him, and he will accept the Torah Shebaal Peh as the word of God. This Rashi is a mu'ad ha-machazik et emrubeh. And this question comes up quite a bit in our community these days, Hilchot Geirut. There's a lot of tumurai, a lot of controversy around about accepting converts and what is required of them, what level of commitment, so on and so forth. And I humbly submit that this Rashi should be studied in the greatest depth by any contemporary posek. And I'll just give you my own humble thoughts, what I understood from Rashi. Does it mean that if a ger does not believe in the divine authority of the oral law right now, at the time of Kabbalah mitzvah, but down the road, someone is convincing and persuasive as Hillel can get him to commit to that, then lemafreya, retroactively, I don't think so. I've never heard of such a svara. To me, it's absolutely absurd. You'll ask your posek. I don't think there is such a concept. It's whatever you're mekabel now. That's the Kabbalah mitzvah. It can't be that down the line you're mekabel more and lemafreya retroactively. It kicks in. So there are two other possibilities, neither of which you want to hear. But I'll tell them to you. One possibility is called orthopraxy as opposed to orthodoxy. When the Gemara Bechoros Daf Lamed Amud Bet says chutz midover echad afil dikduk echad midibrei sofrim, it's all on the behavioral level. We don't really care one way or the other whether you subscribe to the notion that it's only piagvura. What we are interested in is that you are, as a aspiring ger tzedek, are mekabel lemaaseh, to act upon the Torah shebichtav and the Torah shebal peh and all the diktukei sofrim on the behavioral level. We're not interested in your interpretation of history. That's one possibility. That's what I would subscribe to. There is another possible reading of the Rashi, and this is perhaps the way Rav Kook, a friend of the Bracha, would read it. If you open up Igrot Raya, which are not only nice letters of salutation and greeting and blessing, but there's also a lot of halacha in the letters of Rav Kook. So in the Igrot Raya, volume 1, pages 20 to 21, Rav Kook lays down a halachic definition. And he writes, Lo matzinu shedanu chazal din ha-bikoros ki'im al ha-kofer dahainu ha-machalit ha-hefer. The halachic definition of an abikoros is an atheist, not an agnostic. It's someone who says, I know the vada'ut gemura. It's not someone who's misupak, who's agnostic. I don't know. Maybe yes, maybe no. That's what Rashi's saying, according to Rav Kook's take. Now, I didn't see that Rav Kook mustered this Rashi as a proof, so I mustered it for him. Once again, listen to Rashi. Shelo haya kofer the Torah shebal peh. He wasn't a kofer. He didn't say, I know for a fact that this is not from God. I don't know. Lykane and Lylo. Hillel accepted him. He's a Gerzer. Now, there are rabbis in our community today who do not accept Rav Kook's psak. Rav David Cohn recently wrote a sefer on the Yud Gimel Ikarim, Emunah HaNemanah, and of course he has Derech Eretz for Rav Kook because Rav Kook is his Rebbe's Rebbe. Rav David Cohn is a Talmud of Rav Yitzchak Hutner, the Baal Pachet Yitzchak, who in some sense was a Talmud of Rav Kook. So of course, his critique of Rav Kook is becovedic, but he says that which Rav Kook wrote in Yigot Raya, which I just quoted to you, Deloka Hilchus. Moving on, and that's why we're really here tonight, Hopefully I won't keep you until Shkia. You'll get out of here before, but you know what? You better remind me, because those who know me know I can go on and on. It could be a marathon, a filibuster. I'm competing with Super Bowl Sunday.
Not yet?
Okay. So we'll get you out of time. So what we're really here for is a rift between Kabbalists. This great Lithuanian Kabbalist, Rabbi Shlomo Elyashiv, in 1909, publishes his first work, Hofa'at Bechura. It's a maiden voyage, mixing all kinds of metaphors. Sefer HaKadosh, Hakdamot U'Sha'arim, which is going to be the first in a multi-volume series of works of Kabbalah. And his neighbor in the next town over, Birzh, Pinhas Hakohen Lintop, who himself was a Kabbalist of note, writes a letter to Rav Kook in Yafo. And by the way, why was Rav Kook in Yafo? Because Rabbi Lintup put him there. What do I mean by that? This is one of these little known chapters in history. Yeshiva University has such a chapter in its history. The great Rabbi Joseph Alevi Soloveitchik, Zichrono Livracha, wanted to be Rosh Yeshiva here. It wasn't so easy. The Balabatim were not thrilled. He needed some protection. He had a friend whom he had cultivated in Berlin by the name of Rabbi Yosef Yitzchak Schneerson. And one of the members of the board of directors of Yeshiva University was a Lubavitcher Chosid. And Rabbi Schneerson, Rayatz, the Friedrich Rebbe, instructed his Chosid to vote for this brilliant young man about whom he had heard so much from his son-in-law, Menachem Mendel Schneerson, in Berlin, and that's how Rabbi Yosef Ber Soloveitchik got the job. So Rav Kook encountered a similar problem. It seems that in Yafo there was a prominent Chabad community. And it was a mixed community, as a lot of these communities were. There was a fellow by the name of Yoel Moshe Solomon, if you know the history or the Yeshiva in Erets Israel, who was pushing for Rav Kook to become the Rav of Yafo, but Rav Kook needed someone who could vet him to the Chabad community. Rav Moshe Tzvi Neria, the biographer, I know Yehuda Mirsky is the biographer now, but before him there was an earlier biographer of Rav Kook, his beloved Talmud, Rav Moshe Tzvi Neria, who learned by Rav Kook in Merkaz HaRav in the last years of the Rav's life, in the 1930s. Rav Moshe Tzvi Neria revealed this, that it was Rabbi Lintup who put in a word with the Chabad Hasidim in Yafo to accept Rav Kook as a Rav. Why did Rabbi Lintup have that power? Because he himself was the rabbi of the Chabad community of Birzh. Now, there's a big question among biographers and historians. What was Lintop? Was it a chusid? Was it a snagid? Everybody wants to know that. I don't really have the answer. It's very difficult to know. Rabbi Lintop, as I discovered once I started mining this treasure trove, was a yasson. He didn't really know his dad, He was raised by a rabbi, my office, who was a Litvisherhof. And it seems, based on everything I know, that Rabbi Lintup was sent to learn in the Malojan Yeshiva. Rav Kook learned there. I suspect that if we would go back in the annals of the Lintup family, there was some connection to Chabad, but I can't substantiate it. There's a Hemes that I recorded in the book where he writes in a certain passage, he says that I merited to understand this very deep thought in Chabad, Bizchut Avotai, and the merit of my ancestors. Now, if his ancestors were misnagdim, the ancestors might not have been thrilled that he was looking into Chabad. So based on that remez, which is really mishtahir, I suspect that he did have some Chabad allegiance in the family. By the way, I mentioned his father's name, Leib. He had a son named Leib, who was his bitterest critic. You know, sons can be scathing. It's very Oedipal. And especially this son, Leib, named after Rabbi Lintup's father, had spent some time behind the Iron Curtain in Soviet Russia. And he would write letters to his father that were devastating. He would kill his father. He was very cynical. He'd say, I know, you think that you're going to be like the Baal Shem Tov, and you're going to create some kind of neo-Hasidism. Well, it ain't going to happen, okay? Times have changed. The Jewish people have progressed. We've moved beyond that. You're not going to be a Baal Shem Tov. There's not going to be any mass grassroots movement. It ain't happening. Dream on. In fact, Rabbi Lintup was so hurt by that and other letters from his son Label that he asked another son of his, Hadassah's father, Tzvi Hirsch Lintup, who was living in America. This is in 1924. He said, Harav Kook is visiting America. Rabbi Joshua Hoffman wrote the most incredible article years ago, Rav Kook's Mission to America. Rav Kook, together with the Kovner Rav, the Dvar Avram, from the Kana Shapiro, and also the Slobodka Rashiv, Moshe Motchevchen, spent a year here in America fundraising for the yeshivas, which were devastated after World War I. And by the way, that's how I know Yadeinu lo shafchu es adam hazeh. There was the first political assassination in the modern Erets Israel in 1924. Jacob Dahan was assassinated exiting from Dr. Valach's Shari Tzedek Hospital. He had daven mincha there. He comes out and he was gunned down. And it always bothered me, what was Rav Kook's response? Chas v'chalila, did the Rav have anything to do with it? So, Yadeinu lo shafchu es adam hazeh, because in 1924, Rav Kook wasn't even in Eretz Yisrael. He was in America. In fact, Yehuda Mirsky points that out in his recent biography. It's a very important point. So, Rabbi Lintop writes a letter to his son, Tzvi Hirsch. He says, find Rav Kook, find my brother Rav Kook. He's wandering around America. And show him these letters from your brother Label, And maybe Rav Kook can talk some sense into my son, because he's really just cutting my heart. He's killing me. What is the machloket between Rabbi Lintup and Rabbi Elyashiv, Shevach, Shlomo ben Chaim Chaiko? Well, it really goes way back in the history of Kabbalah. It goes back to the 1500s, right after this revelation of Kabbalah Ta'arisa, Lurianic Kabbalah. There developed two schools of Kabbalah. I would call them Pashtonim versus Masbirim. There were those who tried to develop a hasbara, some kind of conceptual understanding of Lurianic Kabbalah, because the Ari came with this vision, as if he's a Navi, you know, it's like Yechezkel HaNavi. And now it has to be unpacked. And what do you do with the vision? So there were those in Italy who were students of the Italian Renaissance, Neoplatonism, goes back to Firenze, to Marsilio Ficino, and especially a very curious, enigmatic, mysterious figure by the name of Israel Saruk, or Saruk, was wandering around Italy, and he taught Talmidim. The greatest is Ramami Fano, Menachem Azariah Fano. Another one was Abraham Cohen Herrera, wrote Shar Shemayim in Spanish. How do you say that in Spanish? Do you know the name of his other book in Spanish? Okay, Bet de Elohim. Casa de Divina. So, why not in Portuguese? I don't know. He should have written in Portuguese. He lived in Amsterdam, and he should have written in Portuguese. He just came back from Brazil. But he wrote it in Spanish. And there was another one who was not a direct Talmud, but he was one of the Ma'atikei Shmua of Rabbi Yisrael Saruk, by the name of Yashar Mikandia, and Yosef Shalomo Rofe, or Del Medigo of Crete, Kandia, Talumot Chochma, Novlot Chochma. And they developed a whole school of Hasbara, an attempt to understand Lurianic Kabbalah with Sechel. And later incarnations of that would be Ramchal and Chabad and Rabbi Lintop. So that's his lineage. However, there was another school of Pashtonim that would hear nothing of it. They viewed this as Kilayim, Sha'adnez. You're mixing together philosophy and Kabbalah. What are you doing? This is an illegitimate move. Lo yavo b'kahal. And the Ari saw things, and it should be left the way it is. If he describes Tzimtzum, then it's Tzimtzum Kipshuto, that it means there was a divine recoiling, a retraction, literally. Don't read some kind of philosophical significance into it. And that is the Leshem. Leshem understands Tzimtzum Kipshuto, literally. So you have the literalist versus non-literalist interpretation of Kabbalah. And there are many, many ramifications of this. One I alluded to at the end of an article I published recently, Chitzei Borim, it's a thick volume. Uh, if you subscribe, as did the Leshem, to the notion of Tzimtzum Kipshuto, then you're left back with the Rambam. And you don't have a notion of Mechadesh B'chol Rega, that God is recreating and reinventing the universe every moment. Because Tzimtzum Kipshuto, God has stepped back. That would be a nafgamina. That would be a very practical outcome. Another one would be what Rabbi Lintup discusses in his letter to Rav Kook. All right, so Rabbi Lintup writes a letter from Birzh to Yafo, and he says, Achi, they refer to each other as brothers. It's like Rav Shlomo Kabbach, you know, those holy brother. That's how they refer to each other. The love between the two men, though they had great chilukei de'ot. I'm not going to tell you that Rabbi Lintop bought into Rav Kook's entire hashkafa. And by the way, it would be naivete to think that the Leshem bought into Rav Kook's hashkafa. This is something that Rav Moshe Tzvi Nerius and Reinhold Rocha kind of swept under the carpet. You know, because there was enough machloket between Hasidim and Misnagdim, and now we want to be in the Kabbal, Pnei Meshichenu, you know, we want to move on with our lives. So the Leshem was not fond of Hasidism Bechlal and Chabad Bifrat, understatement, and he made some statements which you will find only in this book. I'm the only one who has the temerity to publish them. They have circulated in manuscript because, what can I tell you? I'm a fool. I don't listen to friends, talmidim. Rav Kook was attempting a synthesis of the Baal Shem Tov and the Vilna Gaon. Well, the Leshem wasn't into that, you know. But Rabbi Kook's biographer kind of just swept that under the carpet. And by the way, I'm not a total fool. I waited until Rav Elyashiv was nifter before I published his grandfather's remarks about Hasidism. I'm not a total fool. So Rav Lintup writes a letter to Rav Kook that just appeared in print, a very bad book. It's called Hakdamot Usharim by Rabbi Shlomo Elyashiv, and there are terrible things in there. And he quotes verbatim passages, and he says, like, who does this guy think he is? You know, just to pop up now in the times of 20th century and give his own take. He says this is against Ramchal. You know, the Leshem was totally against Ramchal. This is against Chabad. Oh my God, it's against Chabad, you know. And he says to Rav Kook, so I'm about to declare a jihad in the book, but I'm just waiting for your green light for Yafo. And we'll do it. We'll just, you know, the end of the Leshem. Now, what Rav Kook's response to that letter per se, I don't know. Maybe one day we'll discover that response, if there was a response. You have to understand, Rav Kook is now in a very awkward position. He's caught between two dear friends. He loves them both. The Leshem is a dear friend, and Rav Lintup is a dear friend. But in the next letter to Rabbi Lintop, we have the famous statement, which you can hang up on the wall. Bedoreinu ma yafa sichatam shel talmidei hagra yachad im talmidei habesht. In our generation, how beautiful is the conversation of the disciples of the Vilna Gaon taken together with the conversation of the disciples of the Baal Shem Tov. So that was Rav Kook. And I sent out to whoever got it that I hope it won't remain a rift between the Kabbalists. As I said, we really want to, you know, be Mekabel Pinei Mashiach Tzidkenu, so we have to do our homework, and Zavodata Birurim. First, I had to clarify the machloket, but hopefully that won't be the end of it. There will be some reconciliation. So what was it that Rabbi Lintop found so objectionable in the Leshem? And I'll try to explain it to the best of my humble ability. If you get it, good. If not, don't lose sleep over it. I'm going to do it fast. There are four worlds. Abiyah. There's Atzilut, Briah, Yetzirah, Asiyah. Okay, from highest to lowest. And they go from the most ethereal to the most mundane, the most corporeal. And there is a statement of Tikkunei Zohar that says that on the level of Atzilut, the highest of the four worlds, which is next to God, Etzel, like Atzilei Yadav, very close to God, almost God. Ihu v'chayo ichad, ihu v'gamo ichad, which means that he and his life are one, he and his vessels are one. Gamoi would be Kalim. He and his vessels are one. They're indivisible. Echad yachidum yuchad. It's a perfect indivisible unity. Madalav hachi biyot sfirot debia, which is not the case when you go down into these three low worlds of Briah, Yetzirah, Asiyah. There you don't have that situation. Now, Rabbi Lintop, coming from Ramchal and coming from Chabad, understood that on the level of Atzilut, not only the orot, the lights, but the vessels, the kelim, are also Elohut Gamur, absolute divinity. And when he saw statements to the contrary in the Leshem, in the Hakadosh, Hakdamotu Sharim, he was, as I say in Yiddish, deshvokim, he was taken aback, and this dazeh al-achurav. And he reacted, it provoked a very stiff reaction. And again, this goes back to that one great divide. Do you understand simsum kipshuto or delav kipashte? Do you understand simsum literally or non-literally? And since Ramchal and Chabad understand it non-literally, so even after the Tzimtzum, God is still immanent and omnipresent. So the vessels are absolute divinity. Whereas the Leshem, who understands Tzimtzum Kipshuto, they're not exactly that. Now what they are, I say he waffles on the issue, and even after Rabbi Lintop has clarified to me personally his position, I'll tell you what that's all about. And you can't make this stuff up, believe me. I have a wild, vivid imagination, but it can't take me so far. I'm still not convinced, even after I read his lengthy clarification of his position. So, after you hear this, you can go out and tell the people Naor has taken leave of his senses. So, Hopfen Zinnen, he's totally out there. One thing that I learned from this project, it was a learning curve. Dodi Shalachi Dominachor. I learned that there are so many different levels of reality. And we shared together a certain level of reality. But believe me, I discovered through this project, through Rabbi Lintup and the Leshem, that there are other levels of reality going on simultaneously. That's what I learned. And you can call it whatever you want. Rabbi Lintup was buried in Birzh. Oh, I never gave you his dates. Well, he passed away in 1924. He never made it. So, by the way, Rav Kook sent him, as he sent the Leshem, a certificate. At that time, Palestine was a British mandate. And Rav Kook was a chief rabbi. He worked in tandem with the English, and he had access to a certificate, what would you call it, a visa or something. He could obtain for you papers, and he brought over the greatest rabbanim, whoever he could. He wanted to bring over Rabbi Moser didn't want to leave Vilna. Rav Kook said, I'll set you up as the Reish Galuta. You're going to bring back this title, the Reish Galuta. I'll make you Rabbi Moser. But Rabbi Moser remained in Vilna. But he did bring the Leshem, and he wanted to bring Rabbi Lintup, but Rabbi Lintup didn't make it. And he's buried in Birzh. And in the book, I put this photo of his matseva. This was the photo that his descendants had until very recently, and then something happened, which I'll reveal to you. This was taken in 1936, one of the Linfields from America. Remember the name changed from Lintup to Linfield? Went back to visit the old country and took a photo of the father's matseva. Unfortunately, it was winter, and it was partially covered by the snow, and we only had so many lines, and that's what we had. And we also thought that the Rebbetzin, Slova, who survived him, that we know, we thought that she had perished in the Holocaust. Chodesh Tishrei, I got an email from Hadassah. Her email address is Lynn Field, as if her first name is Lynn and her last name is Field, Lynn Field. And she forwarded to me from Yossi Rubenfeld from Detroit photos. And I'll hold them up, and if you want later you can come up and I'll show them to you. Lithuanian Jews, at Yossi Rubenfeld's behest, went to Birzh and they found the tombstones intact, perfectly intact, of Rabbi Lintup, Pinhas Hakohen Lintop, and his Rebbetzin Slova. And here's Rabbi Lintup. We can now read the bottom lines, which are significant, and I'll share them with you. Here's an overview. This is the Rav and the Rebbetzin at his feet, very traditional, kind of anti-feminist. And here's a close-up of the Rebbetzin's Matzeva, also very significant. And that was Chodesh Tishrei. And I, you know, just, if you've ever worked on a project for years and years of your life and something like this comes along, believe me, it's very gratifying. So we learned that the Rebbetzin had passed away before the Holocaust. Thank God she was spared that, because her children, we're told, were burnt alive. Not in Birzh, but in the adjacent town of Krakinova, where the Jews were herded into the synagogue. The synagogue was set on fire, and they were all burnt alive. Harabanit ha-tzedek etzlova eshet hagon ha-tzadik re-Pinchas rabdepo ezrato umsayrato lahagot ba-Torah niftira kavchet elul tavresh tzadei zayin, 1937. If you know anything about Lithuanian Jews, hem lo mafligim b'shvachim. You know, they're not Hasidim. They don't throw these titles around. They're, in that respect, they're kamtsonim. They're very economic with the praise. And listen to what was written on his tombstone, the epitaph, the panegyrics. He adjudicated in our city for 36 years. Wonderful character. He was constantly learning Torah with self-sacrifice. He knew all of the different departments, all of the different domains and subjects of Torah. Now, on the birth certificate, it says the 28th of Avir, but I would go with the Matseva, not with the Lithuanian, not the death certificate. I would go with this. So Zach Iyar, if anybody wants to make a pilgrimage to Birzh, go for it. Well, unknown to Yossi Rubenfeld and Lynn Field, Bezalel Naor also had a revelation, Chodesh Tishrei. Bezalel Naor went to sleep the night of Shmini Atzeret, and right before waking, the morning of Shmini Atzeret, this is what I saw in a dream. I see a book of the Baal HaLeshem, Sefer HaKlalim, and on a certain page is written in handwriting at the top, Rabbi Pinchas Lintup Birzh. And I woke up. Now, I'm a lazy fellow by disposition. I sleep on the third floor of the Svarbar in the basement. Based on a dream, I should be matriach myself to go from the third floor to the basement. The truth is, I owned Sefer Klalim. I never even cracked it open. It's like books you'll buy here at the Seforim Sale. You take it home, you know, because you never know when this will be offered for sale again. It's a winter vibe, but I never even cracked it open. I learned the Seforim I needed to learn for the project. I learned Hakdamot Usharim. I learned Sefer Hadayah, Udrushe, Olam HaTol. That's what I needed. I never even opened up Sefer. Now I have a crazy dream. I'm being shown in the dream Sefer Klalim, and there's written at the top, Repentchus Lintop Birzh. What I understood was that this is the Leshem saying, Aha, Naor, you think you got me? This is my response. Unbeknown to you, I have written the most brilliant, eloquent, incredible response to what you wrote in your little sefer. So, I made the long journey from the, you know, to split level house, from the third level to from my bedroom down to the basement. I pull out the sefer klalim, and I open up, and lo and behold, this is the response. Now, this is a reprint, and you know, I'm assuming that you're all great Kabbalists and you're gonna fact check this, right? So let me tell you what the address. This is Leshem Shvo Vach Lamad Sefer Klalim. It was first published in Yerushalayim, 1926. This is a recent reprint, Yerushalayim Tavshin Ayin, 2010. Ma'amar Avnei Miluim L'Sefer HaKlalim Hakdama L'Siman Chet. In this pagination, it's 342 and 343. It's a Erat Shulayim, it's a footnote which goes on and on and on and on. Now, I've read through this many times. I revisited again this morning to prepare. Fortunately, there was so much tumultai going on in the house, I didn't get far. I thought maybe in the car I'll prepare for the shiur. It is very involved. I find it pilpildik. I don't know whether it would convince Rabbi Lintop, but this, believe me, this is the Leshem's incredible response to Rabbi Lintop's critique. Now, the only thing missing are the handwritten words, or Pinhas Lintop mi Birzh. But believe me, if, you know, if you believe in divrei chaleres lomar lemaridim, this is the response. So, it was a good Chodesh Tishrei. We got photos of the Matseva, of the Rav and the Rabbitzin. We got the Leshem's response to Rabbi Lintop. And, okay, I'm going to shut up now and you can just fire at me. You know, while you're formulating the question, let me just get a drink. Anybody? Yes.
What's the lesson's real office?
Okay, Elyashiv. Now, well, back in the former Tsarist Empire, which I think Putin will soon bring back, Elyashiv. In Eretz Israel, after Aliyah, his grandson, this great Posek, whom I had the privilege of knowing, Posek Hador, Rabbi Yosef Shlomo Elyashiv, Hebraized it as if it's a Hebrew name, Elyashiv, Elyashiv.
The dichotomy that you mentioned as far as a conceptual understanding of Kabbalah and a sort of more intuitive, I would say, right? So where do the misnag, the Groa, Chaim Balazhin, and that school of thought, because I always actually imagine them as fitting more in line with Chabad. But what would you say?
That's an excellent question. I wish I had the answer. It's one of these questions that not a day goes by that I don't wrestle with. Because before I was exposed to Leshem, I too thought that the Vilna Gaon had a conceptual, non-literalist understanding of the whole thing. There were statements to the effect that the Ramchal knew the Nimshal, that it's all a mashal, that the Gaon wasn't sure the Ramchal Vital knew the knew the Nimshal until he came across one work of Ramchal Vital. Mamar Psiotav Shel Avraham Avinu. But the Gros said that the Ramchal, he knew the Nimshal. But now that I've been exposed to the Leshem, and the Leshem certainly believed himself to be faithful to the tradition of the Vilna Gaon, I'm reappraising and reassessing and recalculating, the GPS recalculating the whole thing. I don't know anymore. It's possible. Look, Chabad said, and it may make be a falsification. They said that the Vilna Gaon understood Simsum Kipshuto. There is this passage in the Tanya, the Shah Yichud Vemunah, Perek Zayin. And here you might get the shock of your life. Until the year 1900, when the Rebbe Rashab, Rav Sholom Ber Schneerson, had the Tanya reprinted in Vilna by Usher Shub Nikolaev, we didn't have a crucial passage in the Tanya. If you go back to all the editions of the Tanya pre-1900, Shar Yichud Vemuna Perek Zayin, you will not find the passage where the Balatan Tanya talks about those who understand Tzimtzum Kipshuto. Shigigat miktzat hachamim be'eineha, the mistake of some who are wise in their eyes they're wise, but they're not truly wise. Evidently, this passage was preserved in manuscript in the Schneerson family. It didn't go out. And in 1900, for whatever reason, the Rebbe Rashab, and some of my family were in Lubavitch by the Rebbe Rashab, so I have to have their heads for him. For whatever reason, said the Higiazman, Higiazman Gulatchem, but the Higiazman, we're putting this in the Tanya print. And to whom is the Balat Tanya alluding? Well, he's certainly alluding to Rabbi Immanuel Chai Riki, Bal Yosha Levav, who was an Italian Kabbalist who lived in the 1700s, early 1700s, had a machloket with Rabbi Yosef Irgas, Shomer Hunim, where Irgas, who was the Rav of Livorno, understood Tzimtzum non-literally, like the Shar Shemayim, like Abraham, like Moin Herrera. And is he also referring to the Vilna Gaon? And that would explain why until 1900, that could not be published. This kind of slur, miktzat shigigat miktzat chachamim be'einehem, the mistake, the error of some wise men in their own eyes, because it did refer to the Vilna Gaon. Rav Kook denied it. He said it's not referring to the Vilna Gaon, chas v'shalom. The Korpus der Rebbe, I have writings of the Korpus der Rebbe. By the way, Rav Kook's maternal grandfather, Rav Fall, was a Kabbalist of Chassid, so Rav Kook should have known. Anyway, the Kabbalist of Rebbe writes, yeah, that of course it refers to the Vilna Gaon. Who else is he talking about? The Beltraim, the Tzad Shigat Chachamim Beinayim. So Chabad held that way, based on reports that they received, that the Vilna Gaon understands Tzimtzum Kipshuto. I'm sure the Leshem has that take on the Vilna Gaon. So now we have our work cut out for us. We have to forget all the shmuot, forget what was reported and the name. We have to go back to the Kabbalistic writings of the Vilna Gaon and see Is it kipshuto or shalom kipshuto? Okay, another question?
No, just a follow-up, because if you look at the Voloshiners, the Chaim and the Yitzhak, it certainly seems that they were basically rephrasing the Tanya. They are, but they may be revisionist, though. They may be an anachronistic re-understanding of what the God is saying.
You have to be careful, because, you know, they're descended, the Soloveitchiks are descended right. from Chaim Voloshiner. You know, this yeshiva is very much under the Soloveitchik fan. This is Volozh, okay.
So, can...
That's why we sang the Negan of Rabach Ben.
Is there any way to address al Rekalachas Rabbi Lintup's claim in reconciling Simson Kipshuto with continuous creation? Or
you mean to make peace? But...
No, in other words, one assumes that the Leshem agreed with the Yud Gimel Ikrim if he attacked Rabbi Lintup for saying that they were saying that not everyone agreed with him. So that being said, how does one, and if we say that the Leshem believed in Simson Kipshuto, is there
Let me just back. I don't know that that's the reason that the Leshem accused Rabbi Lintup of being an apikoros. Rabbi Lintup he states it as a fact in the letter that this, he said, he caused me a lot of trouble in my town of Birzh because he told the people I'm an apikoros. Why? I don't know. I'm just surmising. Maybe it's because Lintup wrote that the Yud Gimel Ikrim are not the be all and end all.
No, even if that wasn't the reason, is there any way to reconcile Simson Kipshuto with the idea of continuous creation?
Well, there's a very holy Jew here by the name of Rabbi Eichanan. And after I published my article in Chitzei Giborim, Rabbi Eichanan showed me writings of Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson of Brooklyn, in which he arrived at the same conclusion that I did, that if you hold Simson Kipshuto, you can't really have a concept of continuous creation. Nahon? By the way, something I wrote in the article which might interest you, and nobody else has this, I haven't read everything under the sun, but I don't think anybody has this. Why did these people, the Balati, do we need to... Yeah, okay. Why do these people, living in the 1700s, or beginning of the 1800s, why do they stress so much Hamachadesh B'tuvo V'chol Yom Tovin Masiv Reishis? They put so much stress on it. The Tanya, and also the Nefesh HaChayim. I believe that that was a reaction to Voltaire, to deism. Because in the 1700s, in fact, you know, Benjamin Franklin in Philadelphia, at least for a portion of his life, was a deist. He also spent time over in Paris, where, you know, which might have influenced his thinking. But that philosophical movement of deism spread throughout Europe, to America. In fact, if you read the travelogue of the Chidah, he writes how pernicious the influence of Voltaire is on Jews, or even rabbis in France. The Chidah, Chaim Yosef David Azoulay, was wandering around France back in the 1700s. He was allowed to see the Royal Library. The Queen of France allowed him to see the treasures of Judaica there. It became the Bibliothèque Nationale in Paris today. And there's a passage in the travelogue of the Chidah where he says he's speaking to a certain rabbi and he says he's totally off. He's come under the influence of Voltaire. So that was a very dominant philosophic influence in the 1700s, and I believe that for that reason, the Balei Tanya and also Nefesh HaChayim came back with a swift reaction where they went to the opposite extreme. Because what is deism? In a rough and ready manner, it's, let's say, God. It's like the universe is a watch, and God winds it up, and now it ticks on its own, and God is, Masulak. God steps back, because the universe is ticking on its own now. So they come back with the opposite notion. They went minakotze lakotze, that hamachadesh betu v'chol yom termasvish, and you get a very, I would say, almost exaggerated statement of it in the beginning of the Beis Halevi, who's a grandson of the Nefesh HaChayim. Okay, any other questions?
That was very enlightening, but my follow-up question was going to be, does deism naturally follow from Sixth of Shushan?
So what
is the middle ground? If you say they're both extreme, what is the middle ground?
What would be the moment?